My years in Yosemite were the best years of my life. That was where I was training and I was learning the skills of big wall climbing, and I wanted to find walls and that people hadn't done before, and I wanted to pioneer my own routes. But you know, a conclusion that I did come to from going on all these expeditions, climbing is kind of a selfish pursuit. So I start thinking, what can I do with this, with these skills that I've built up as a climber? And I come across this issue of National Geographic, Tepuis, Venezuela's Islands in Time, May 1989. I don't know how I found it. I opened it up. Guess what? There's giant rock towers in the Amazon jungle. They're called tepuis. I thought, wow, how do you get up one of those cliffs? That looks awesome. The article, of course, is not about that. It's about science. It's about the summits of these mountains being the home of like all these endemic species. And they've evolved separately. We're talking plants and animals from their cousins that live down in the jungle below. Everything up there is unique. One of these unique creatures is called pebble toad. There's a couple things about them that are really unique. If you look at the hind feet, they are adapted for climbing in a way that's totally unique. I think there's 8 species of pebble toads. 5 of them have been found on the top of tepuis. And I'm thinking, whoo, okay, I'm starting to get the beginning of an idea here. The guy who's trying to figure this all out, why do these creatures happen to exist on the summits of these tepuis? Dr. Bruce Means. This guy has been on 32 expeditions to the tepuis. He's a biologist. He's found tons of new species. So Bruce and I, we come up with this plan. And this plan is custom made for National Geographic. We say, so have your people been up on the summit of this mountain? And they're looking at it and they're like, oh yeah, our guys have been up there. They go up a helicopter. They found a lot of cool stuff. They're like, okay, that's cool. Have you guys been down in the bottom in the jungle? They're like, oh yeah, totally. Our guys have been all over the jungle. They found a lot of stuff down there. They're like, oh, that's cool. Have your guys been here in the middle on the veg patch on the actual wall? And they're all like, They're like, actually, no, I don't think our guys have been on the wall. And that's when Bruce like slams his fist down on the table and says, I guarantee that I will find new species on the Tepui wall. The only problem is now we've told them that we're gonna go up where the veg is on the wall. And as a climber, that's really not the way you wanna go. You wanna avoid the veg. So we've got ourselves a little bit of a problem. Like most of these adventures, the best part of it is connecting with the local people. So here in the Amazon, it's Amerindians. And we needed these guys to help us to get into the base of the tower. There's no possible way that we could have found it. We did not anticipate that the hardest part of this trip was gonna be just getting to the base of the tower. You can see this ridge right here. This doesn't look that bad. This looks like a ridge, like in the Shenandoahs, right? You hike up this thing. That little section there, which is half a mile, took us 5 days. And what you can't see is that it's actually really steep under there, and it's jungle mountaineering. And we would scrape our way up these little walls, and then we'd build these little ladders. We'd put ropes down, and we'd put these rungs on so that we could all move up with our gear. But eventually, we came to this spot that we called the slime wall. Bonafide slime. So like at this point, we've climbed all kinds of different stuff. Like all different kinds of rock and ice. I even climbed grass in Poland in the Tatras, which is another great story, but I had never climbed slime. The closest that I came was trying to climb the grease pole at the Freiburg Fair in Maine, but slime is really, really, really hard to climb. We were relying on going up these vines. We think the highest we got up the wall was like 10 feet, and then the vines would break off. We'd slide down the wall and then hit this little ledge, and you had to hit the ledge because there was a huge drop-off right to the side. The Amerindian guys thought that this was probably the greatest show that they had ever seen in their life. And eventually we're like, hey, you know what? Guess what, dude? You're giving this pitch a go. Edward was like, he didn't speak English, but he kind of got the message. He was all like, what? I'm leading it? And we're like, yeah, dude. Here's your harness. and we suited them up. Well, guess what? The Amerindians, like, these guys must have gecko blood or something, because this guy got on the slime wall, and he just went right up it. The problem was that we hadn't really looked that carefully at, like, the upper section, and we just thought, get past this slime part, it'll get easier. Well, it didn't get easier. It went from slime to dirt, which was good, but it went from 80 degrees to like 90. So he went for like another 20 feet up the dirt by putting his hands in all the way up to his shoulders, and was like grabbing onto roots and kicking his feet in like he was like ice climbing. This eventually brought him to a roof of vegetation. And we looked up and we saw him up there and we're like, oh man, this is bad, you know? And we're like, he'll figure it out. He has to, because he can't down climb it. So he's got his arms in all the way like this, and he starts going like this. And he starts headbutting the wall. And we're all looking at each other, we're like, this is bad. They're like, he's headbutting the wall. And then on one of the headbutts, he bit on, and he went, and he tore off a little patch of moss. And we're like, wow, now he's biting the cliff. I'd never seen that. Never seen anyone do that. Well, he starts biting off chunks, and we quickly realize, like, he's chewing a hole through the wall. And he chewed the hole big enough to like get his head started, and then he started burrowing into it, and he turned into Mole Man. And it took a long time. Over the course of like about an hour and a half, he burrowed his way all the way into the dirt. And the last thing I saw was his leg sticking out in the back, and he was like this, and he was shaking to try to get himself deeper in. I remember one of his shoes fly off and spin through the mist and disappear off the ledge. And for the rest of the trip, he had one shoe. But he did it, and he burrowed all the way through, and he got out onto the ledge, and we couldn't see him at this point, but he let loose with this blood-curdling scream that I think was like half triumph and half like terror. And the story was, is they heard it in the village 40 miles away. But he was definitely stoked, and he allowed the expedition to proceed. We made a little camp up here on this ridge, and we have this one last little hill to get to the base. So I got up early in the morning before everybody else, and honestly, I was feeling bad. I'm like, I'm making the Amerindian guys do the hardest stuff. Like, I gotta redeem myself. Now it's matted dead wood laying over the cliff. It's really steep, but instead of being slime, it's rotten wood. And I'm trying to climb it, and it's all just breaking off. But it's like this layer, and a couple of times the whole thing collapses, and I fall through into the inside, and I look up, and I can see that there's like a space on the inside. It's almost like kind of like a chimney that you could slither up. And I looked up in there, and I thought, what would Edward do? I'm like, he would go in for sure. I'm like, that's what I'm doing. I'm going Mole Man. So I put my hood up, I cinched everything up, and I started squirming my way up through here. And I was in there for hours, and straight up, there were tarantulas in there, scorpions. It was wicked hot. It was probably the nastiest thing I've ever done in my life. Finally, I hit a wall at the end. I broke all the wood and veg out above me, and I popped out, and the Amerindian guys are like sitting there. They're looking at me, and they're like, Marco, where the hell have you been? I was like down under the veg. I was doing like what you did yesterday. They were like, you idiot. They're like, we found this trail around the side. They're like, we've been here for hours waiting for you. Well, don't forget, we've told National Geographic that we're gonna climb up onto the veg patch and we're gonna try to find some new species. But the veg isn't really where you wanna be on these cliffs. The veg is a nightmare, actually. We kind of found this route where we hit a little veg patch partway, we dug in, we actually got some samples. every time you would stick your hand into the wall and you would pull it out, you would have either a tarantula or a scorpion in your hand. We had slightly more scorpions, so we ended up calling our climb the Scorpion Wall. We had an awesome adventure up on this mountain. We're on the mountain in the background there, and we're flying away in a helicopter. We fly over this other tepui. Bruce doesn't even know about it. He's been on 32 expeditions here. And as we go over the top, we see this giant sinkhole, and there's a forest down inside. And so Bruce looks at that, and he thinks, you know what? That is exactly the kind of place where I need to go, because it's the environment that's right in between the tepui summits and the jungle down below. And I think like this missing link type of frog that I'm looking for is going to be down in that hole. And my only job is to get Bruce down in the hole and then to get Bruce back out of the hole. So we get Bruce down into the hole and we leave him down in there. It's really kind of wet and nasty down in there. So we have this nice dry camp up on the top. So we go back up to our camp and we hang out and we drink scotch and we look down in and we see Bruce down in there. Like the frogs, he's basically nocturnal and we hear him rooting around and he's got to find this thing. But he's having a hard time finding it. And it's like day after day. And here's a little video clip that tells the story pretty good about what happened to Bruce down in the hole.
And there on a little leaf sat one of these priceless little babies. And then I realized, ooh, they do what the lower elevation one does. They may sit on leaves, and I start looking. Within 10 minutes, I found another one. And then by 9:30, I'd found four. This is fabulous. I do want to stay another night. I'd like to do some more work on the ecology. I didn't have my camera with me. On and on and on, yada, 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 but we're successful! Yahoo!
After he found the frog, we had like a little celebration down in the hole, and Bruce fell over. There was a tree right there, and he actually broke the tree off. It was like super lucky. Because he was gonna hit the ground like a sack of potatoes. I'm thinking, okay, I gotta get this guy out of the hole. So here's another little clip showing how I got him out. I'm trying to set up basically the beefiest rig that I've ever set up in my life, just to make sure that we can get Bruce out of the hole. I pretty much tied together this entire troll forest. I think I have 10 trees interlinked. This is one of the crazier things that I've ever set up. I can confirm that he just moved up about 6 inches. So he's got 199 and a half feet to go. Well, we did it, and we got him out of the hole. Bruce loves to show this picture. And if he was here, he would tell you that I tried to kill him, but I did have a backup rope. So I had two ropes, but he likes to sort of pretend that that didn't happen. But it's one of his stories. So Bruce has looked at the DNA of the pebble toads, and guess what he found? The separation is only like a few thousand years. The tepuis have been isolated for more like millions. So what does that mean? It means that the frogs have been climbing up and down. And there's exchange going on between the frogs that live down in the jungle and the frogs that live up on the top with this one species. There's another species that he's found that has been separated from its cousins by millions of years. And so Bruce says to me, that makes perfect sense because those ones aren't adapted for climbing. So you have both things going on at the same time. So you have the old paradigm and you have the new paradigm. So the guy's 71. His first rappel is a free hanging rappel into a sinkhole on a tepui. Kind of a tough place to learn how to do this.